people think about houses as in place of where we live. Some of you sent Christmas cards to me. Now I know it's not Christmas. And, you know, you can send an Easter card to somebody's house because Easter's coming up. But sometimes when we say this is the house of God, the church building, that's, we leave it as being the only place that God has dwelt. And the truth is, we understand that we are the temple of the Most High God. So he dwells in us. We are his tabernacle. We're his house. This is the house of God that he has built. And there are many sanctuaries. God is everywhere at all times. And that's very important. But this building is just made of brick and mortar, and one day will fall down and be of no use anymore. Hopefully someday when we're not around, hopefully it'll last a while we're here. But we need to understand what is really the house of God. And so as a matter of fact, we're going to talk about this. Before I go any further, I want to give you four words. If you're taking notes, write these down. Because these are the four things as we talk about how God has put his house together and also what it really means for the house of God. The first word is design. How many of you know he is the master designer? He designed the world. I don't care what anybody says. They can believe in the Big Bang. To me, the Big Bang is God said, let there be, and it was. Bang. It happened. He is the designer of the world and the world systems. And then the second word is desecration. There's the design, there's the desecration. The third word is desolation, and then destruction, the four D's. As we get into this, we're going to find out that there's a pattern that runs throughout the Old Testament all the way into the New Testament, and it's going to talk about these four particular truths. First of all, God designs a house, right? He designed you. It's the reason the psalmist said that I was formed in my mother's womb. God knew me. That he knew you in your womb. He knew you when you were just a seed. He knew you before the foundations of the world. He knew you. God designs a house. And then that house gets desecrated, and I'll talk about that. And then as that house gets desecrated and emptied, God moves out and it becomes desolate. And then destruction comes. Now you say, well, that's rather ominous. It can be. But it doesn't have to be. If we're God's house, are you listening? Now y'all don't be quiet on me. I know we're getting somewhere. So the first house that God lived in was Adam. Isn't that right? He created Adam, and then he created Eve. That was now, you know, he dwelt in the garden. He created the heavens and the earth, and Adam was the first mankind that was made in God's image. Adam was, as a physical being, he had a body, he had a soul, and he had a spirit. And the Bible tells us that we are made in the image of God because God is a triune being, and we refer to that as the Trinity. Now, I want to make sure, because I've got friends of mine that come from a oneness background, and many people will tell you, well, you know, you people believe in three gods. We do not believe in three gods. We believe in one God who is manifested in the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. There are not three gods. If you read the Bible, you figure that out. But the Father is not the Son, and the Son is not the Spirit. They are three distinct personalities in the Godhead, but there is one God. He is a triune being, meaning that eternally he is existent in the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. That's really important to the foundation of our faith. We have a body as beings. We have a soul. We have a spirit. And we are made in the image of God and the nature of God. We worship one God who has revealed himself in three persons, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. So if you're watching me today and you say, man, Pastor God, I can't get past that. You know, the one thing, we were having this conversation the other night about this similar subject. You know, where most people trip up over whether it's Father, Son, Holy Spirit, or in the name of Jesus, is over water baptism. They'll argue over how you're baptized. I settled that years ago. I learned from an old preacher friend of mine. Gerald Pryor. I hit them all. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, into the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. I want to hit them all. Because you say, well, that's just, you know, you're just, you know, doing, just trying to, you know, what's the word I'm looking for? Huh? Cover your bases is one, yeah. You're just trying to make everybody happy and not make anybody mad. No, the truth is, folks, that first of all, baptism is not an essential of salvation. Jesus is the essential of salvation. Now, we should be baptized. I saw the other day, young lady in our church put on there, I'm thinking about getting baptized. You know what I said? Let's do it. Let's get the tank filled and bless God, we'll baptize you. Why? Because it is a foundational piece of our life. 1 Thessalonians 5:23 says, now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. May your whole spirit, soul, and body. Now let me explain the difference and show you that God prefers his house to have three rooms. I don't know what all is up behind me, but y'all are all, is there scriptures up there? Are y'all seeing everything I'm saying? All right. I'm just wondering because everybody's looking over my head. They don't usually bother me, but for some reason tonight, I'm noticing it. Sorry about that. Y'all pray for me to stay focused. Adam had a body, and with that body, he had a physical life, and he knew this physical world. Meaning that the world beneath him was it was part of the physical fleshly life. John 18:36 says, Jesus said, my kingdom is not of this world, but we are in the world, but we are not of the world. Jesus prayed, Lord, I pray that you would help them, these disciples who have to live in this world, I'm going to paraphrase it, who have to live in this world like you and I, we have to live in this world. Lord, help them not be of the world. Why? Because we can live in the world and not have the world in us. Does that make sense? We need to not live after the mandates of the world. We don't live after mandates of the flesh. We should live after what the Spirit and the Word of God tell us. Now, that's the body. But what about our soul? Anybody know what the soul is? I used to have a chart. We talked about all these things when I did the teaching years ago. We do in foundational teachings, the soul is the mind, the will, and the emotions of a person. You ever heard somebody say the eyes are the windows to the soul? And that's because sometimes you can look deep into a person's eyes and you can see into you can't literally see what they're thinking but you can many times sense what they're feeling and what they're going through by the depths of what's in their eyes. Have you ever looked at somebody's eyes who's angry at you? How many of you know they don't have to say a word, but you know they're angry? Right? Come on, men. I know you know what I'm talking about. Those eyes, they get you. Right? You ever heard of the look? Ain't none of you men going to amen. All the ladies are saying, yeah, they know it. And watch this. The soul of a person, the mind, the will, and the emotions of a person live inside of you. The Greek word for the soul is the psyche. It's the word we get with psychiatry and psychology and so forth. The soul is made up of what is going on in our mind, our thought life, our emotions, whether we're happy or sad, we get angry, or we're all the emotions that we have. And the will of a person. What is the will of the person? It's what you choose to do. It's your will. Now, I know there's popular teachings that, you know, there's all kinds of teachings on the will of man, whether we have free will or whether you don't have free will, or whether you can make a choice or not make a choice. God's made the choice. We're not going to dive into those things, but you have a will because you are a being. It's part of your emotional state. It's part of who you are as a man and a woman in this life. And your soul, the mind, will, and the emotions of you are temporary because you're not going to carry that, because we're going to be redeemed one day, praise the God. Isn't it good to know that when we get to heaven, and when we all get to heaven, we're We're not going to be sad anymore. No more tears of crying. We may shed tears of joy and worship, but there's not going to be joy. There's not going to be tears of sadness. You ever been sad? Yeah, I mean, we all go through those times. You lose someone you love, you weep, you know, there's all kinds of things. And this whole range, I mean, you know, some people can go from mad to happy to mad in, you know, less than 10 seconds. I mean, you know, this whole gamut of emotions, things externally affect your emotional state. But when we get to heaven, we're not going to have to rely on those anymore. God's going to redeem them. Praise God. Your soul is your sense of humor, your personality, your likes, your dislikes. It makes you the unique person that you are. And that's awesome because God didn't make any of us just alike. Wouldn't life be boring if we were all just alike? Now, I know I've known people that think if everybody was just like them, thought like them, acted like them, that the world would be a better place. But I've known them people, and I can tell you for certainty that's not true. It's good to have the variety of people. That's the reason why, you know, it's great to have different color people in the world, because it shows us the whole gamut of God's creation. That's the reason why if you hate somebody because they don't look like you, they're a different color or whatever, you're hating God. I'll say this whenever I make these kind of statements, but if you hate somebody because of the color of their skin, you will not go to heaven. You just won't. Now, I don't want you to go to hell, but that's the reality. You can't, because it's God's creation. That's like saying, now, you know, everybody loves dogs. And I like all kinds of dogs. I prefer some dogs over other dogs. I hate cats. Cats won't be in heaven. I'm just joking. So every person has a body, they have a soul. But what about the spirit? In Hebrews 4:12 says, that the word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than a two-edged sword, dividing asunder between soul and spirit. So what's the difference between the spirit and the soul? Both are invisible, both are inseparable, yet both are different. For example, plants have a body, but they don't have a soul, right? They have a body, they have a stem. The Bible speaks of living creatures, but what separates us from all the other creatures? It's the spirit of man. Now, we understand, and we'll talk about this in a few moments, but when Adam and Eve sinned, the Bible promised that the day you eat of this tree of good knowledge, you will certainly die. How many of you know Adam didn't die? He lived for 900 some odd years. What died in him that day? Was the spirit, because that spirit was in unison with God. But that spirit became separated. With the body, you know the world beneath. With the soul, you know the world around you, the physical world. But with the spirit, you get to see who God is. You get to see we're made in the image of God. Psalms 34:18 paraphrase says this, I will dwell with him that is of a humble and contrite spirit. God, if you are humble before the Lord, if you humble yourself before God and the spirit of God is made alive in you, you're going to humble yourself and you will what? He said, I'll dwell with you. How much you want God to dwell with you? I like God dwelling with me, don't you? When you get saved, God's spirit bears witness with your spirit that you're a child of God. How do you know you're saved? Because God's spirit witnesses with your spirit that is made alive because of the work of the cross. That spirit comes alive, regenerated. That which died in the garden is made new inside you at salvation. It's the reason the scriptures teach us that they that worship him will worship him how? In spirit and in truth. God designed a house that he could dwell in. And he occupied that house. In other words, he was the designer of it. But then came sin. And this comes to the second word that we looked at. We have the designer, and now we're going to have desecration because of sin. Remember, I said this a few moments ago, that God told them, the day you eat of the tree, you will surely die. And they ate, and they died. But they didn't die right away. We understand that the spirit died. But God designed the house that Adam and Eve, he designed the garden, he designed everything, and sin desecrated what God made. In other words, they dirtied the house with sin. Now, some of you are clean freaks, and you know you hate dirt in your house. And you get mad if your kids come in. If you have kids, you get mad if they, you know, you've cleaned the house and they trample in mud or something like that. How many of you parents ever got mad at your kids for doing that? None of you. Okay, you're all liars. Not all of you. Some of you may not have really cared. I don't know. I lived with a woman who cared if you messed up her house. Let me just tell you. We have desecrated the house of God that he designed in us with sin. If we understand the depths of what sin does to us. God made this perfect everything, and man desecrated it by his sin. And because of that desecration, we move on to the third word of this, and that's desolate. Why has it become desolate? Because God moves out. He moved out. The spirit died, and God no longer dwelt with man. Now, he dealt externally. We know that God was still with Adam, but he no longer lived in him. There was no longer that communion of spirits. Desolation, that place of being separated from God, is a horrible feeling. Now, the problem with most people is they don't really recognize exactly what it is they're trying to feel. That's the reason people say, you know, I don't care what I do. If I can drink, but there's just something. I can do drugs. There's still something missing. I can have sex. And there are all these things. There's still something missing because you can't feel the void of the desolation that took place in the garden because of the sin of Adam with the things of this world. The only thing that fills the void that is inside of us is Jesus himself. Separation from God. How many of you know sin still separates us from God? Now, the great news is the Bible says if we confess our sins, if we're a born-again believer, if we sin, we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us. I'm grateful for that because I don't know about you, but I've needed him to forgive me, right? I know some of y'all are holy, and you didn't need that forgiveness. But the rest of us mortals, we need Jesus to forgive us even after we got saved. I still need him, right? Do you? I'm asking that not as a rhetorical question. I'm really asking that because sometimes I think we forget just how much we need Jesus every day of our lives. We can be doing this thing so much that we really lose sight of the fact that every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before, but every day away from him begins to lose the luster of life. As Christians, I mean, you can cease breathing and your body stop functioning, and praise God, we can go on to heaven, and that's going to happen one day, should the Lord tarry. Amen? But there's something about the spiritual death in a person, the spiritual death that's in living in, that's the reason people can be evil. That's the reason why, I'll just be honest with you. If you take someone who professes to be a Christian and there's no change in their life and they're still as mean as a snake as they always were, they ain't saved. Because there's got to be some change. That don't mean you're perfect. But this void, this death inside of us is made alive by the Spirit of God coming and regenerating that dead spirit that died in the garden with Adam. Hallelujah. There's good news tonight, though. Can I tell you something? David, you're never going to die. Yeah. You like. Martha said, oh, dear God. We know that's true because to those who are a believer in Jesus Christ, this flesh will lay down one day, but we're going to live forever with him. That's good news right there, isn't it? That's the good news. Hallelujah. Oh, man. Paul tells us that to be absent in the flesh is to be what? Present with the Lord. If you're a believer in Jesus Christ. Here's the truth. You'll be more alive once this body lays down than you've ever been in your existence on this earth. Hallelujah. Because we'll be in the presence of the Lord Almighty. We'll leave this old dirty body behind, this broken down thing that hurts and aches and everything else that goes on with it and can get diseased and all these other things. And, you know, your teeth hurt and your back hurts. And yeah. Anybody ever endured any of those things? Come on now. Let's just be real about it. One day that ain't going to happen no more. Praise God, when we get to heaven, all them teeth we forfeited here, we're going to get them back. Hallelujah. And they ain't going to be false teeth. They're going to be the real thing. That's not in the Bible, but I believe it. Because I'm hoping we ain't walking around, you know, half toothless or, you know, when we get to heaven. God say he's going to make all things new. Bless God. Give me all my teeth back. And my hair. Bless God. David wants his, he's putting his order in. Lord, I want my black hair back and sideburns. Wants the pork chops. One day we'll leave this earthly body to live eternally with God forever. Death doesn't separate us from God, but it brings us to a greater existence in him. It's imperative that we understand that death in the spirit is different than the death in the body. Death in the spirit will eternally send you to judgment. When we're dead in our spirits and we're not made alive by Christ, we will spend an eternity in hell. Here's the reality for every person who's ever walked the face of this earth. You're going to live forever. Where you live is the difference. We either live with Jesus or we're going to live with the devil and all his fallen angels. And when the Lord moved out, when he moved out of their life, life goes out of it. And there's desolation. There's desecration. There's desolation. It's empty. Adam was an empty room, just like we are without Jesus. So, Lord, how do we begin to deal with these things? I hope some of this is sinking in, because too often we think because we get a goosebump in the emotional realm that we're right with God. And the truth is we're right with God because of what Jesus did, not because I get a sensation. Now, I believe you do feel the presence of God. I'm not saying that you don't. I love that old song that my Aunt Joy used to say, something I can feel, something I know is real. I believe that you can feel the presence of God. You know when God is really present in you because you've been made spiritually alive in him. So we have a house that's desolate.